Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our session, The Next Generation of Storytelling, Cybergeddon, a Case Study. Please welcome our moderator, CEO of the Opportunity Management Company, Brian Seth Hurst.
Good afternoon. So I am, I said my challenge in today's panel is to not act like a fanboy. I would like to know how many of you know or have seen Cybergeddon. So you are really missing something. I am absolutely serious, and it is best, I don't know how you want people to consume it, but it's best consumed all at once, one right after the other,
yes.
You know.
Binge.
Even with it, it's delicious. So I want to introduce our panel, and then we're going to rock and roll. You're going to have to sit up straight and pay attention because we're going to move fast. Anthony Zeiker, you may have known this man or heard this man's name from CSI, but he also happens to be a pioneer of, I would just say, emerging media and defining what the next generation is in media. And that includes Level 26, which scared the crap out of me and gave me nightmares. Ron Chance from Symantec,
yep,
represents the new partnerships that technology companies are making with content creators, and we're going to talk about that. David Freeman, who I always treasure my meetings because we always discuss something new. David Freeman from CAA, and Bill O'Dowd from Dolphin Media. This company has taken the opportunity, the chance to be at the forefront and to pioneer the new funding of content. So what I want to introduce you to is, if you're not aware of it, there is a new ecosystem that's being born. Storytellers like Anthony, they want to hold on to their rights and their intellectual property so they can make more money, but also that they can do what they want with their content. Technology companies, they now want content-driven customer acquisition. That is getting inside a story and telling their story to agencies. They have to change, and they have to be at the forefront packaging. And financiers are now beginning to understand that a lot of people are going to act like studios, but it's best to go with master storytellers when you're taking a risk. Right, Bill?
Absolutely.
So Cybergeddon is an example of this new ecosystem and this collaboration. So if we can roll the trailer, that would be great. Thanks, Dave.
We have you electronically get the rights. Cybergeddon. Documented espionage, creating email history, money transfers.
You're going to jail. Thomas, somebody is framing me.
I'm remembering your face. Never want to forget it. I own your life and can take it away with the push of a button.
The girl's on the run. What's your next move?
Disappear. I need your help.
Hell no.
16 minutes ago, the Bank of Hong Kong received a zero-day virus attack.
Whoever did this is a Pope.
It's Gustav.
Gustav Dobrev?
How is this even possible? He was extradited back to the Ukraine.
Let me take you in and we'll prove it.
No, we don't have time.
Don't make me do my job.
I started this. I'm gonna end it. If I die, I die.
I always forget to do this. Twitter is at Zeiker, right?
Yes.
Twitter?
At Norton.com.
Yeah, at Norton.com. Mm-hmm.
No Twitter.
No, yeah. Twitter.
On purpose.
At Dolphin.
At Dolphin Digital Media.
At Dolphin Digital Media, at Brian Seth Hurst. And if you're hashtagging, you can hashtag Cybergeddon or hashtag there is no sec, as in security, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so 9-part series, 10 languages, distributed in 24 countries. I'm going to start with you. How did this come about?
Well, I think it came all the way back to the writer's strike. You know, when we're doing the writer's strike, us as writers wanted to be able to do brand new content and not have anybody kind of tell us what to do and really reach out and be an artist. That's when Level 26, the books kind of came out. We did a lot of interactivity inside of that. And that was sort of my first foray into the, you know, immersive interactive world. And then we talked with David at CAA, and and said, how do we do this on a bigger scale beyond publishing and get into motion picture business beyond the theaters and really want to incorporate brands and facilitate a need of brands being involved in this and really blow it out and have scale. And so we sat with CAA and met Bill and went up to see Rhonda at Symantec and just gave him a pitch. We didn't have a script. We had an idea. We knew that, you know, CSI was crime for my brand. I wanted to do the next iteration of crime, which was cybercrime. And we sat down and pitched this philosophy of incorporating talent and narrative and brands all together and scaling day and date, where you shoot in May and air in September. And it sounded super exciting. It's the first time it's really been done at that level. And we pulled it off. And that's how it all began.
So, David.
Yeah.
Did you have a relationship with Dolphin already, or from a packaging standpoint, were you looking for?
I think the key that we knew right away was that if you're going to jump in here, you need a partner who's going to commit to it. Meaning, we were going to make this, with or without a brand. You know, we were going to figure out distribution. I mean, you know, the beautiful thing about Bill, because of his second window and his expertise in what he's done in TV, we knew off an Anthony Zeiker name that part of the financing could come in a second and third window. But we needed a partner who wanted to make this, right? Because it's hard in my world, and fortunately now a lot of our clients, Anthony leading the way, want to play in this ecosystem. But we need to know that these things are going to get made. So we had some discussions with Bill, and he was one of those guys who still today sees the future and believes that TV's not going away, but it's going to change, it's going to evolve, right? And digital is very much a way that we can reach and match consumer behavior. So Anthony had an idea. Anthony and Symantec were already talking from my years past when I was at Matter. And then there was just the grand marriage. I mean, there was a lot of parallel tracking that happened. We made the deal between Dolphin, Zeiker, and then we very soon after were starting to talk to Rhonda, even pre-distribution, which is rare in this ecosystem, because brands.
But I kind of have to give you kudos, and you'll probably agree with me, Rhonda, because you know we were pitched when we were representing Intel for content, and you guys managed to cross all the T's and dot all the I's, and not only that, but you were so willing to listen to the brand and what the brands needed, yep. And that was something you wanted, right? It didn't feel like a compromise. You said, okay, we're entering the world of cyber terrorism. What greater match could there be? And what did you think when it was first pitched?
Well, you know, let's be frank. So where we come from a brand standpoint, is that security software, on the face of it, is a snooze if you talk about it from that standpoint, right?
Until your identity's stolen.
Right.
And then it becomes really important.
No, but just, you know, rip that off. And right below that is espionage. Right, cybercrime to the tune of $110 billion a year. Right, every person, every second, 18 people are a victim. So it's like the story, as you said, the character is super rich.
So when a quick question. When you the day of the premiere, some of the banks were hacked. Did you kind of like set that? I mean, for real, it was like a perfect PR for you.
Well, of course. That's. I mean, our point is cybercrime's happening every day. Right, it's happening every minute, every day, and that story. Storyline to be able to work with somebody like Anthony to tell our story, for us to be the authentic voice, to let Anthony meet with our team in the response center that see these millions of threats every day, and then let him take that storyline and be the creator
that
he
is. Did Anthony have to have security clearance to come in there?
He did.
Ah!
Absolutely.
Darn it.
Yeah.
So Bill, as from a financing point of view, so David's packaging, because I marvel at it just sort of came together. It was kind of beshert, as we say in Yiddish, meant to be. But it just kind of came together. And were you hands off? Were you actively involved? Were you, what was your?
Oh, I don't know. You know, it depends on the day, I guess. But we were actively involved in the project, clearly. And I think what happened with this, honestly, I give a lot of credit to Rhonda. When you do something for the first time, it just takes faith on mm-hmm. both sides. And I think to do something of this scale for the web that wasn't, that was a true fictional story that was out there instead of a true, just something only for advertising, then it just takes faith on both sides that we're gonna, you know, cross bridges for the first time together. And sure. I remember when we were doing our deal, there's no template There was no contract. We're writing, what's important to you? What's important to you? And figuring it out. And I think that's what I remember most from the early days, was just a trust.
Well, when you watch, and I really recommend, if you have any interest in what it is to create content from a different medium, from the packaging point of view, from the brand as character point of view, from the business model point of view, and from the production point of view, this is a case study. This should be in like Harvard Business School or at least USC Film. But the idea is that the brand was completely integrated. So I think it like really starts to show up in episode 3 maybe, where Chloe goes, the main character goes in. And by the way, talk about a great female lead and putting a powerful woman in a main character role and having a great foil for her in Kit Gurry. It's just the chemistry is so great. You have to understand this is excellent content. And for people who have poo-pooed the internet for so long as like cat videos and stuff, to be able to see something of high quality, but the rhythm is different. It is not television.
It's definitely not television. And I want to second what Bill said, because Rhonda, she is amazing. Because when you think about, I've worked with so many brands before Cybergeddon with CBS, and I got to tell you, Hollywood is such a fear-based industry, scared to death of their own shadow. So the thing to go up north and talk to a software company, you know, there was really no fear. It was like empowerment. You know, she really got up from the pitch. She went upstairs and fought like hell for the dough. Came and invested, supported. And again, it's not just product placement per se. Do we have a character that works for Norton? Sure. Is there like a Norton sticky in the movie? Great. Is there a little poster that says Norton? Awesome. Is there a Knox Center in there? Sure. But the real victory
Network
is...
Network Operating Center.
Yeah. But the real victory is Symantec, Rhonda, myself, Bill, all approaching this venture as partners from the very beginning. From the pitch phase, the outline phase, the script phase, the shooting phase, the ancillary content phase, the .com phase, conversations from the very beginning, and respectful to where you do what you do, we'll do what we do, and that's a relationship that's very, very hard to find, and when you find it and it works, it's utopia for the future of storytelling.
So when you talk about the traditional writer's room, which you have lived in most of your life, I'm guessing.
Yes.
Was Rhonda part of the writer's room?
Well, even better, she flew us up there to her neck of the woods to talk to all of her experts about cybercrime. So all the terminology, the storylines, the research is all authentic. And we committed to Rhonda and said, hey, we want to give you a great level of entertainment, but also a great level of edutainment inside the picture. And that was
so that would be episode 4.
Sounds like I'm password for password.
So in episode 4, the funny thing was when Rabbit, the character, goes, and the free software that came with Hastings, with Arthur's computer, protects him against nothing. And then you do this, what the security threat is. You like list it. You say, our everyday activities.
Yep.
And you have scenes of people on their phones and clicking, I'll never click a link again, clicking a link that a friend sends you. Mm-hmm. And it sort of spells out this that this threat actually doesn't begin with a cyber terrorist per se going after large corporations. Yes. It actually begins with you, which I was thinking, well, this is a good reason to get Symantec security, because then you gave, in the story, you gave each individual a reason to consider their own security.
Right.
So it wasn't about contaminated water, it was about your identity being stolen.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's the opportunity for us to have an educational moment that's entertaining and you can actually get it, is exactly what we were trying to accomplish, right? Mm-hmm. That the threat isn't about what happens on the PC anymore, right? Your phone is connected to the internet. Everything's connected to the internet today. And so having Anthony be able to kind of understand that threats that are happening in social and mobile, which is 1 in 5 people have a social and mobile threat happen, have that come across on screen so that awareness can now be there so that you inherently now understand, oh, I need protection. I wasn't thinking about that. I just thought it was about this PC. And it's good storytelling. And we've seen results. We see a 20% lift in educational awareness that it's not about the PC anymore. It's about all these other places and that you need a different kind of protection. It's not about antivirus anymore. That game's over. It's a whole new era of protection. And this helps us do that.
So you brought up a good point, and I just want to go to the left for a minute.
Yeah.
So Anthony, very successful storyteller, has a fan base. He's like storyteller rock star. A lot of the storytellers today, like J.J. Abrams and Tim Krang and Anthony, they have their own fan bases. And when they do something new, their fans flock to them.
Yep.
And their fans create data. We covered this like briefly on the phone. And other people make money from that data. Not you as an investor, not you as the storyteller, not you as the agency. That data has inherent value. Should the storyteller and the investors be making money from that data? Should they own that data?
Well, I mean, here's the thing. The way I see it is this. You know, my job is to tell a great story. My job is to create a brand new medium for the future of storytelling. My job is to be a really good friend to brands and say, hey, feel safe here when you put your brand in my hands. So if somebody else is making money, you know, on the side for data, God bless, make money. Point being is the relationships on this stage are solid. We're heading toward the future as a pioneer in the industry to make sure we're molding new ground for how to tell stories in this new age of technology. And that's really the most important professional goal for me. My personal goal is to be a great dad and to be an awesome husband to my wife to be over there sitting there. And so beyond that, I don't care about who's making money off of data. For me, it's just about doing a great job and being a great artist.
Yeah, I mean, just to answer your question, I don't think it's about that today. I think it, because I know where you're heading and I know how you're thinking about it. I think down the road, monetization in this space is something we're going to figure out. But, you know, and Anthony puts it, you know, the best, the winning is in the doing, right? I mean, that's where I think today, and this is a successful venture that we did, right? We were able to accomplish many of Rhonda's goals. We were able to drive audience. We were able to create a new business model, both for consumers and for brands and for investors. And that's what we achieved, right? I mean, I can't be the only one not to compliment Rhonda, right? I mean, these guys did too. So, But you have to have the right person at the brand who understands that you are walking into the abyss. You don't know. And you have to have the stomach, and she did, and all of us did, to understand we don't exactly know. I think our partnership was sealed in January of last year, exactly what our distribution plan, exactly what our marketing plan is, exactly. And we were able to figure that out and work together and work through it in a way that made it meaningful.
So. This is kind of different than going to an ad agency who has a content division, who stands between the brand and the storyteller, and then says, here's what we're gonna do, here's how we're gonna spend the money. This is a direct relationship with the brand without an agency. What did your agency think of this?
Well, again, this is a part of a whole mix. So I have a fabulous agency, produces, you know, amazing work for me, and that's, you know, that helps me educate, you know, audiences in one way. But this, I mean, look at any of the big brands, Procter & Gamble, you know, BMW, all of them are working with their ad agency to develop storytelling that is, you know, very, you know, tightly integrated in that way. I really felt that not owning the story is more authentic, and I believe it's what the generation certainly that we're really trying to reach. That's what they're very attuned to. Though they love that storytelling with those other brands where it's ad created. I'm not saying they don't because it's some beautiful work, but we really wanted to go on a trajectory of something that hasn't been done.
So. I had the honor of working with Tim Krang on Conspiracy for Good, where Nokia played a very similar role.
Yep.
Their agency wasn't involved.
Correct.
They gave Tim a great deal of autonomy.
Mm-hmm.
Tim was able to consult with them and go back and forth to figure out how to satisfy their goals while driving the story forward.
Yep.
And I use the analogy that it's like a musical number in a musical. It should drive the story forward, not detract. And so it's so well integrated. Do you think traditional television will continue, otherwise we wouldn't be sitting here.
Yeah.
But do you think that this is a new model that now is coming up? And David, are you looking at those packaging opportunities?
Yeah, I mean, look, I believed in it for 10 years. I mean, and I think it's coming, and I think it's coming fast. I think brands want to be integrated upstream. And that is this model, to bring brands in upstream, right? I mean, brands are still downstream as it relates to film and television, right? And brands now have audiences, right, and have to feed those pipelines, those social media owned and operated sites. I mean, there's a number of different ways that brands have to connect directly with their audiences, and storytelling is going to be that. And I think in this ecosystem, there's a new opportunity for engagement, right? I mean, and the analytics here are tremendous, and I think the analytics, to some degree, outweigh what you can do and what you can measure in traditional television.
And if we switched your question before from data to audiences, I was going to say to audiences, then having storytellers, financiers, and brands have the engagement with the audiences. Yeah. That's one of a couple different distinctions I think that's different with the online world versus traditional television, let's say. And I think as we grow and things we'll learn this year more than we even learned last year, then I think about opportunities in social, taking brands and storytelling and really expanding on a global basis the social opportunities for these types of products.
Well, you look at audiences, just from our research, they want to be a part of the story. They want to participate. Yeah. They want engagement. They want to add to the conversation. I wanted to ask, with distribution on Yahoo, how does that work for audience engagement? How would that work for social engagement? Because you have all these different platforms, you have a linear, you had a casual mobile game, and if the next season involves a deeper level of social engagement, then who owns that audience? Is it Yahoo because they're the distributor, or would you have a different platform? Would there be a Facebook hub per se, or?
Rhonda's smiling, yeah. Knowing smile. Listen, I have a feeling these conversations are happening.
No, Rhonda's smiling because this was a big discussion point early on in the development, right? I talked about unknowns. We had a very successful and continue to have a successful partnership on Yahoo. You can go see it now on Yahoo. I think where we're evolving to, I think, and not just as relates to this property, but all properties, is you have to be able to service your property inside a number of different communities, right? And so, yes, next iteration, much deeper in Facebook, much deeper in the social streams, shorter exclusivity windows, and being able to window in a number of communities. Why can't we move from Yahoo to four other different communities at the same time? So anyone who thinks that you can't continue to learn and evolve here and that knows everything today just isn't really in the space. So we're looking at that now as it relates to the next iteration of this and other properties that that we want to launch that are similar. And I think, how do you reach audiences in a massively fragmented online environment, right? And that's the key. And I think social, if we had to triple down on something, it would be social, 100%, in terms of the way media dollars are being spent.
When you look at, I want to talk about production for a minute, the timeline, the fact that the great thing about this is you've established best practices. Each episode ends with a cliffhanger, and they're not trite cliffhangers. They are totally, it rolls right into the next thing. It's not like an act break. It is a self-contained episode that leads you on to the next. So how is that different, creating in that format for you? Is that something you did by instinct, or is it something?
Much different philosophy. I mean, everything, you have to develop content. The number one rule that I learned from Mark Andreessen from Netscape was make sure you create original content that's specific to the device. So I had to make sure that we were approach this completely differently. I knew we had to open up very, very strong story-wise, that we had to keep the pace very frenetic. We had to have amazing characters that you can get into and have a big time cliffhanger to make you want to come back for more. I used to joke in the room and call it Homeland. Ever seen the show Homeland? I want to do Homeland, but in 9-minute episodes. Because it's so good to have really great characters and great story, but fast, quick, multiple screens, levels of engagement, graphics. So when you first, I used to walk down the hallway with Jerry Bruckheimer at CSI, and he would stop at the editing bay and go, whoa, see that? Maybe a frozen picture of CSI. That's what motion picture should look like. That's what CSI should look like. So when you channel surf, you stop and go, wow, that's got a look to it. That was the CSI philosophy. The Cybergeddon philosophy is pace, character, strong open, strong cliffhanger, and do that 9 times over through the course of a 90-minute episode to where when you watch it, you realize instantaneously this is built for the device. It's not conventional television or movies.
Well, what I loved is I could carry it into the bathroom. I can't carry my television into the bathroom.
That's correct. Yeah.
Roll it in the I mean, advantage. Seriously, you got to go. You don't have to pause because there is no chance to pause here.
No.
Except maybe you got to roll back to catch titles and things that you might have missed. But the The one thing that I did notice that was just so simple but so elegant is that when the characters are looking at something, because you're dealing with data, you're dealing with screens, you're dealing with stuff, the screen is split. It would be as if you were seeing that on your own computer. It's in that size, it's in that ratio, yeah. So you definitely have the experience of reading the email as you would on your own. Deliberate?
Right. Yes.
Yes.
And also, considering that the smallest screen is going to be, you know, the iPhone, so I would tell the director, you know, not too many big, cute masters, like really, really, really tight. So I don't want my characters to be this big in the viewing experience. So we made some modifications like that, but everything was a bit different. The schedule, the shooting, the writing is all the same. Grueling, giving birth to a watermelon, tough. Hurry up and, you know, race through it. It was a very, very tough schedule. But when you shoot something in May and you air in the fall, and nowhere in the history of entertainment can you turn a movie around, a motion picture around, in a couple of months. And that's the power of Bill and a great company, and the power of a great brand, and in collaboration, and that's going to be the model of the future beyond the theater.
But the other art of it that Anthony and Bill help with is there's a second window. Right, so we're moving out of the first window into a second window, right? And so
it's essentially not, it's 95 minutes of content, 90
it's
minutes?
It's around 90 minutes of content. Yeah. So the beautiful thing is what Anthony and Bill talked about is, okay, let's make sure that we're producing for the first window on all these different devices, but how do we put it all back together so that Bill and his expertise and what he's learned in foreign TV and home video, it can act as a 90-minute film. And when we premiered it, we showed it as a 90-minute film. And it works as a 90-minute film.
Sure, it sure does.
And the brand value that Ron is going to get for this thing over the next 3 to 5 years, which is what we always talk about when we sit down with brands, is don't just think about the value you're getting out of the first window. There's a long second window and a third window, and it's going to continue to grow as we continue to make more.
So let's talk about that in terms of media spend, because when we're in
I knew you were going to say that.
Well, he queued me up. I did.
Perfect. Brilliant. Well, Here's the interesting analytics, sort of like behind the scenes, right? So CSI in year two, a 30-second spot was $857,000. Can you imagine that for
30 seconds?
30 seconds. Can you imagine T-boying through that? Like, oh my, where'd my money go? If you think about that same kind of commitment for Cybergeddon, and what that money could do for the longevity of the dollar spent. So you not only do you get a motion picture, but you'll be getting a thing called Zips, which are Zyker clips, which are 6 one-minute episodes as ancillary content. It's going to live domestically, iTunes, foreign sales, Netflix, Epix. It's going to have a shelf life of content for easy 20, 30 years, on top of baking in the brands just for conventional product placement, that you would get far more for your dollar than you ever would to go through a 30-second spot on a one day in time on the second season of CSI. And that model is going to change everything. Because that's real staying power for your buck.
You've had, how many millions have seen around the world to date?
I think after, 3.5 months, we're about up to 30.
So 30 million people have seen this. Mm-hmm. And when you think of a media spend, because we talked briefly in the room, so if you wanted to play on a Fox television show, and you wanted to be placed in the television show, you'd have to make a $20 million media buy on the network, most likely.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to make a product placement fee, and then that might be stripped out some way for foreign distribution.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, and it's just that one little, you know, it's just that one little set of buy versus this, which has such longevity, as well as international, right? It's international. And really, all we did is we looked at our whole media spend. Like I said, we haven't stopped doing all the other things. We just said, how can we take a slice? Get into something that we think is very much on the innovation edge, and get in, jump in, take a little bit of risk, jump in and see what you get out of it.
I said I wouldn't throw any curves but I'm just gonna throw a little one. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, so the idea is you're investing media dollars, which usually you only get a return on impressions. That's
correct.
Your measure of success. Are you acting as a studio in investing in this? Are you getting a return on your investment? Or how is that working? Are you an investment partner? Is there a revenue share? Or are you not going to answer the question?
Yeah, no. I'm not going to. But it's not. It's not a, I'm not getting revenue share back.
So do you think brands would look towards that in the future?
Of course, it's a new model. Of course, it could be on the table. Absolutely. And what we're doing is testing all the, we're testing out everything, right? We're getting all the numbers behind everything. Downloads, clicks, what we said, social. This is a group that said, let's jump out there first. Let's understand what this can be. And that's
so. And I think one of the things that Rhonda hit a really good point that we haven't talked about yet, which is, you know, one of the advantages. Why do something in this medium versus television? Because both of us have made, you know, our companies built on television, and there are great things in television. I think the internet offers a couple of advantages, one of which is, or differences, and the ability to go global day and date. So Ron did mention international. You just can't do that on television. We've had a television distribution company since 1996, and even in our kids' programs, where we know we're going to sell it on to every Nickelodeon channel around the world, you're not going to premiere on the same day and date. You may not even premiere in the same year, as I'm sure many people in the room know. So the ability to go to, you know, we tested it in 26 countries and on the same day, and not just 26 countries in Latin America that all speak Spanish, right? We broadened around the world, so in 10 different languages, in Germany, France, down in Latin America, Mexico, Brazil, so we had Spanish and Portuguese, Australia, Canada, but then also into mainland China, Cantonese, Mandarin, so that just to give us testing, and that's where you get this great massive global reach. So for those brands that care about global, or even just regional, that's something that I think is exciting for us to explore.
And the audiences went wild because they usually don't get first window stuff right away.
Right.
Especially I mean,
China,
in Asia.
Well, China and Asia, it just exploded because he's got an existing audience there. Mm-hmm. Rhonda's on the ground marketing there, and they were so excited to get something new, the way that North America gets it right away, that it just kind of exploded.
And you have international hashtags,
correct.
So the conversation begins. I want to ask, I want to give the audience some time for questions, but I have one quick question for you and then a wrap up. Conversational indexing is coming. That's where the audience begins to converse about the characters, and a lot of storytellers are starting to like listen to the audience, not to alter their story, but I had one storyteller say, oh yeah, sure, what you do is you give them what they want and then you take it away from them. So the analogy he used was that there were two characters that everybody wanted to see together, so he put them together and then he killed the guy off. So are you aware of that? Does that figure into the storytelling?
Sure, I mean, you know, you cannot have a peer-to-peer relationship with your consumer on television or in the movie theater for the most part, but you certainly can when you watch Cybergeddon. You certainly can get instantaneous feedback on what particular segment they liked, what character they liked. You can take suggestions from them in terms of where storylines might be going, and I think that's invaluable feedback. In the TV space, they said, yeah, we tested it, and it came back X, Y, Z, and you have to believe what they tell you. This actor's great, this actor's not good, it's too slow here. You're just believing it. We don't really have the real analytics, but for the movie, we have all the analytics, where things were peaking, where things were dipping. And we'll use that stuff into the second script and say, hey, when we approach our openings, our closings, or our climactic scenes, or our character turns, let's maybe turn the hot sauce up here, or dial it down there, or do multiple. We'll give that feedback to the writer, and then we'll produce it that way. And it's very sort of learning by fire with instantaneous feedback, so data becomes really, really important. We don't listen to everything they tell us, but we never ignore what they tell us.
But when it trends, you kind of...
Absolutely. I mean, it's invaluable. It's mm-hmm. We're doing more behind-the-curtain stuff the network ever did quicker because we have a more... hands-on relationship with our users.
Well, I got to say, from an objective perspective, there is this really interesting balance of serious and comedic.
Sure.
That actually works in the rhythm and the pace within the episodes. So that just when it gets really intense, you have these moments with the relationship between the two characters, Rabin and Chloe, that are working together, that are actually getting your message across. And I always say, if you want to teach somebody, make them laugh.
Yes, absolutely.
Get your message comes across with this humor that actually makes the point.
Yes.
So I want to ask, before we take questions from the audience, biggest takeaway that each of you have had from this experience so far? Bill.
Choose your partners well.
Yeah, I wish I'd learned that in my relationship.
Okay. I think it just excites me from where I sit and working inside with some of the greatest content creators in the world, like Anthony, that this space is alive, it's well, it's healthy, it's gonna evolve, we're gonna get better at it, and you know, as I say, 2 years ago there wasn't as much incoming, and now in our where I sit and where I work, everybody wants to understand it, and everybody wants to jump in.
So has this gotten the attention of the other CAA talent clients
that are looking
into this now?
You know, and that's exciting, right? And when the storytellers see it, now it's gonna get even better. I think we've proven to the brands and to the audiences that premium does exist online, and now I think we're at even though it's the most mature it's ever been, we're now at the starting line to a certain, you know, degree. And that's what excites me, because...
Do you think we've hit that inflection point yet?
I do. I absolutely do. You know, I
mean, yeah, and as somebody who's financed and produced a couple dozen TV movies, I mean, for, you know, I would like, I'll stack up Cybergeddon against a primetime TV movie, and that's an inflection point, right?
Totally.
There's the quote. That'll be in the... Yeah. In the
so
daily.
That's what's exciting.
I didn't mean to do that.
Yeah. my biggest takeaway is really similar. It's like, pick great partners, because that, and to be able to do this where they really understood what our big takeaway, the key things that we wanted, and to be able to deliver on those, I couldn't be happier, right? In the sense of how many people we've reached, the number of downloads, you know, everything we were trying to do and test, and then to be able to go, you know, to go in and say, what are we going to do next? How are we going to tweak this? How are we going to get better?
Had you thought of brand as storyteller or brand as character or any sort of alliance?
Absolutely. You and I hit on that a little bit. It's like, we're really clear about the purpose of the brand and who we are and the story, which is what we started with our ad agency. So huge, you know, huge play that they delivered for us, so that we, when this came along and I was looking for something bigger to tell the story, it was really easy to make a decision with somebody like Anthony, because the purpose is spot on with his storytelling.
Anthony,
the win is in the doing. Yeah. That's it. I gotta tell you,
best
the win
quote.
Is in the doing, because you know what? It was just the biggest pitch of our internet life was just the pitch of concept. We have this idea and this movie and these characters and the script we're yet to write, and trust us, we can really do good. Mm-hmm. And then them saying yes, now we have proof of concept.
Yeah.
I can now show everybody a movie and ancillary content and a business model and a relationship with references. For a company, we have done it successfully, and we could prove to say, here, kick the tires is what we've done. Now we can really move this into a deeper relationship and open up a whole new business model and change everything, and that's worth doing.
So, what would you tell new storytellers in the audience that are coming into the business? You came up through the TV side. What would you say to them of their opportunities?
We are in the golden age of storytelling, wrapped up in a great revolution of technology. And anybody who tell a great story can win in this space.
Questions? I can't see. Yes, if you could, I think there are microphones running around the floor. So we have one up here in the front as well.
Hello.
Hi, could you tell us your name and what you do and then ask your question?
Rafael Garcia, digital accountant from Sistemas Group. A lot of things align for you guys, a great brand, global brand, with a global distribution and the right writer. Everything came together. So how do you think this can be actually replicated to actually make it not just a case study, but actually something that happens every day with projects?
Best practices. Established?
I think it's finding that marriage. It was organic with Anthony's vision of cybercrime storytelling with Rhonda's brand goals. So it's looking and being creative, thinking about what would work there, right? Because this can be replicated. We believe it. We're going to finance it.
And I think Anthony just said it. It's now real proof of concept with business models attached to it. So looking at it as a case study gives you a way that you could put it together. The two things that were just said, golden age and choose your partners carefully, those are the same rules that apply across any media, by the way, that there's always a chance for great stories to break through. And now you have the platform, but you have a proof of concept. So looking to this as best practices where everybody cooperated, and you kind of did leave your egos at the door.
Oh, by the way, what we do is really, really hard.
Yeah.
Make no mistake. It's hard to write a great script. It's hard to infuse a brand. It's hard to get along when you're in production. It's hard. It's hard to do this. So when it all comes together, like The Godfather, it works forever, and some things don't work. So there is no perfect success business model to do this, you know, successfully every single time. But it just has to make sense. The right story, the right partner, the right trust, work your butt off, and hope for a good result. And that goes for everything we're going to do in the future.
Yeah, I would also say that any story that that a writer is thinking about in the sense of what they're trying to do absolutely has a list of probably 10 brands that might fit within the crux of that story.
Especially
that
they're trying since
to
brands
tell.
Are more, with millennials, they're more about enabling lifestyle today than they are about,
Absolutely. So it's there. You just got to, those two have to look for
it. Yeah, it wasn't like we did a cybercrime movie and we have a big hamburger sponsor. You know, it was a
relevance.
It was a cybercrime software company with you know, the creator of CSI doing a crime movie. It felt like a really good marriage.
It was organic.
It was. It
and I would also say, we didn't do things one step at a time. You got to think about it holistically. You got to think about story. You got to think about audience development. You got to think about distribution. And then you got to think about marketing, right? And so for those that are jumping in, keep those things in mind because they are so interconnected and so important to the end result.
Well, and the truth is you have to know how to bring the audience to the property
100%.
Now, especially in a digital
and I,
world.
And I do
you
think
don't
that's,
have
one,
that
that's one thing we have to figure out in this space, right? We're still dealing with a lot of technology companies who are distributors. And, you know, this clearly the studios have figured out a marketing science and P&A against film and how TV shows. And that was a big role that Rhonda played as well, that we knew going in, that support that she gave it, that activation that she gave it, to lift it up and to use her traditional media and the ways that she's reached consumers to actually drive, you know, engagement.
Which is the other side of the brand partnership is we already have an audience
Absolutely.
Of That's customers.
Right. 150 million customers
That's
that,
right.
that
That's exactly
got
right.
to interact with it.
And retail yeah. and yeah. all those things.
I keep saying if you can grab the Harris Affinity program, they've got like 40 million users. Put a casino security risk in there and then get them.
Yeah.
there was a question right here at the front.
I had a question about your launch and how you, and that there's a public relations that you're touching upon to get to 26 countries at once. And how did you do that? And how do you maintain that audience as well?
Well, I mean, there's a whole go-to-market strategy that was a combination of Yahoo, ourselves,
YouTube,
Dare to Pass team. So, I mean, we had PR screenings, pretty much three or four major ones that we sent Anthony and the team to, but we had them all over the world, probably in 20 different countries that we were located. We had, you know, truck tours. Like I said, we had in-product activation. We had retail activation. Yahoo, huge partner. In all of those locations, that you know, front page banner. Driving people to the property. Like we were saying, the marketing is not to be underestimated. The off-property buys required to bring people, you know, back on the property. Huge part of it. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more. Can't see, so if you're raising your hand.
This gentleman.
Here? Here? Where?
Okay. There's one in the back.
Okay, right here then, and then one in the back. Maybe we can get two more in.
Hello, my name is Nico Franks. I'm from NATPE Daily. You mentioned that Cybergeddon definitely isn't television. So how will you get potential customers to pay for it as if it is television on services such as Netflix?
How will we get... Well, I mean, the relationship with Netflix is a second window Netflix. I mean, you know, I mean, and there's a number of the second window, you know, providers that we're looking at, right? I mean, our SVOD, subscription VOD-based... So, you know, that falls into a traditional model of they may be licensing for us for a period of time for a territory. So we are taking advantage of, and certainly Bill has a lot of experience here that he brought to the table in terms of how do you monetize that content globally over a 3 to 5 year run. So whether that's Comcast SVOD or Netflix or home video or foreign TV, that's really a lot of what Bill also brought to the table because he's been doing that for 20 years in TV very successfully.
Yeah, I think we launched on Yahoo September 20, let's say 5th-ish. And we were at MIPCOM with it in the first week in October and sold very successfully internationally and for television and other rights. So it's a testament to the product. But that's the idea here is not just to live online, to premiere online, but then to go elsewhere.
That's right.
So we're at time. Sorry for the last question. Bill, David, Rhonda, Anthony, thank you so much for being here today. Cybergeddon.yahoo.com. Long tail. Better catch up before the second season so that you're all caught up by the time it gets there. Thanks for your time today. And thank you.
Thank you.